with strain, elevating a candlestick, with pain, feeling on his right temple a contused tumescence, with attention, focusing his gaze on a large, dull passive and a slender, bright active, with solicitation, bending and downturning the upturned rug fringe, with amusement, remembering Dr. Malachy Mulligan's scheme of colour containing the gradation of green, with pleasure, repeating the words and antecedent act, and perceiving through various channels of internal sensibility the consequent and concomitant tepid pleasant effusion of gradual discoloration. His next proceeding? From an open box on the majolica-topped table, he extracted a black diminutive cone, 1 inch in height, placed it on its circular base on a small tin plate, placed his candlestick on the right corner of the mantelpiece, produced from his waistcoat a folded page of prospectus, illustrated, entitled Agendathna Tame, unfolded the same, examined it superficially, rolled it into a thin cylinder, ignited it in the candle flame, applied it when lighted to the apex of the cone, till the latter reached the stage of rutilance, placed the cylinder in the basin of the candlestick, disposing its unconsumed part in such a manner as to facilitate total combustion. What followed this operation? The truncated conical crater summit of the diminutive volcano emitted a vertical and a serpentine fume redolent of aromatic oriental incense. What homothetic objects, other than the candlestick, stood on the mantelpiece? A timepiece of striated Connemara marble stopped at the hour of 4:46 a.m. on the 21st of March 1996, matrimonial gift of Matthew Dillon. A dwarf tree of glacial arborescence under a transparent bell shade, matrimonial gift of Luke and Caroline Doyle. An embalmed owl, matrimonial gift of Alderman John Hooper. What interchanges of looks took place between these three objects and Bloom? In the mirror of the gilt-bordered pier-glass, the undecorated back of the dwarf tree regarded the upright back of the embalmed owl. Before the mirror, the matrimonial gift of Alderman John Hooper, with a clear, melancholy, wise, bright, motionless, compassionate gaze, regarded Bloom, while Bloom, with obscure, tranquil, profound, motionless, compassionated gaze, regarded the matrimonial gift of Luke and Caroline Doyle. What composite asymmetrical image in the mirror then attracted his attention? The image of a solitary, ipso relative, mutable, aliorelative, man. Why solitary, ipso relative? Brothers and sisters had he none, yet that man's father was his grandfather's son. Why mutable, aliorelative? From infancy to maturity, he had resembled his maternal procreatrix. From maturity to senility, he would increasingly resemble his paternal procreator. What final visual impression was communicated to him by the mirror? The optical reflection of several inverted volumes improperly arranged and not in the order of their common letters, with scintillating titles on the two bookshelves opposite. Catalogue these books. Thom's Post Office Directory, 1886. Dennis Florence McCarthy's Poetical Works. Copper Beech Leaf, bookmark at page 5. Shakespeare's Works. Dark Crimson Morocco, gold-tooled. The Useful Ready Reckoner, brown cloth. The Secret History of the Court of Charles II, red cloth, tooled binding. The Child's Guide, blue cloth. The Beauties of Killarney, wrappers. When We Were Boys, by William O'Brien MP, green cloth, slightly faded, envelope bookmark at page 217. Thoughts from Spinoza, maroon leather. The History of the Heavens, by Sir Robert Ball, blue cloth. Ellis's Three Trips to Madagascar, brown cloth, title obliterated. The Stark Munro Letters, by A. Conan Doyle, property of the City of Dublin Public Library, 106 Capel Street, Lent, 21 May, Whitsun-Eve, 1904. Due, 4th of June, 1904. 13 days overdue. Black cloth binding, bearing white letter number ticket. Voyages in China, by Vieter. Recovered with brown paper, red ink title. Philosophy of the Talmud, sewn pamphlet. Lockhart's Life of Napoleon, cover wanting, marginal annotations, minimizing victories, aggrandizing defeats of the protagonist. Saul und Haben, by Gustav Freitag. Blackboards, Gothic characters, cigarette coupon bookmark at page 24. Hozier's History of the Russo-Turkish War, brown cloth, 2 volumes, with gummed label, Garrison Library, Governor's Parade, Gibraltar, on verso of cover. Lawrence Bloomfield in Ireland, by William Allingham, second edition, green cloth, gilt trefoil design, previous owner's name on recto of flyleaf, erased. A Handbook of Astronomy, cover, brown leather, detached. 5 plates, antique letterpress, long primer, author's footnotes, nonpareil, marginal clues, brevier, captions, small pica. The Hidden Life of Christ, black boards. In the Track of the Sun, yellow cloth, title page missing, recurrent title intestation. Physical Strength and How to Obtain It, by Eugene Sandow, red cloth. Short, but yet plain, Elements of Geometry, written in French by F. Ignat Pardies, and rendered into English by John Harris, D.D., London, printed for Orr Naplock at the Bishop's Head, M.D.C.C.X.I., with dedicatory epistle to his worthy friend Charles Cox, Esquire, Member of Parliament for the Borough of Southwark, and having ink-calligraphed statement on the flyleaf, certifying that the book was the property of Michael Gallagher, dated this 10th day of May, 1822, and requesting the person who should find it, if the book should be lost or go astray, to restore it to Michael Gallagher, carpenter, Doucery Gate, Enniscorthy, County Wicklow, the finest place in the world. What reflections occupied his mind during the process of reversion of the inverted volumes? The necessity of order, a place for everything, and everything in its place. The deficient appreciation of literature possessed by females. The incongruity of an apple incuneated in a tumbler, and of an umbrella inclined in a close stool. The insecurity of hiding any secret document behind, beneath, or between the pages of a book. Which volume was the largest in bulk? Hozier's History of the Russo-Turkish War. What, among other data, did the second volume of the work in question contain? The name of a decisive battle, forgotten, frequently remembered by a decisive officer, Major Brian Cooper Tweedy, remembered. Why, firstly and secondly, did he not consult the work in question? Firstly, in order to exercise mnemotechnic. Secondly, because after an interval of amnesia, when, seated at the central table, about to consult the work in question, he remembered by mnemotechnic the name of the military engagement, Plevna. What caused him consolation in his sitting posture? The candour, nudity, pose, tranquillity, youth, grace, sex, counsel of a statue erect in the centre of the table. An image of Narcissus, purchased by auction from P. A. Wren, 9 Bachelor's Walk. What caused him irritation in his sitting posture? Inhibitory pressure of collar, size 17, and waistcoat, 5 buttons. 2 articles of clothing superfluous in the costume of mature males, and inelastic to alterations of mass by expansion. How was the irritation allayed? He removed his collar, which contained black necktie and collapsible stud, from his neck to a position on the left of the table. He unbuttoned successfully in reversed direction, waistcoat, trousers, shirt and vest, along the medial line of irregular incrispated black hairs, extending in triangular convergence from the pelvic basin over the circumference of the abdomen and umbilicular fossicle, along the medial line of nodes to the intersection of the 6th pectoral vertebrae, thence produced both ways at right angles and terminating in circles described about 2 equidistant points, right and left, on the summits of the mammary prominences. He unbraced successfully each of 6-1 braced trouser buttons, arranged in pairs, of which one incomplete. What involuntary actions followed? He compressed between two fingers the flesh circumjacent to a cicatrice in the left infracostal region below the diaphragm, resulting from a sting inflicted 2 weeks and 3 days previously, 23 May 1904, by a bee. He scratched imprecisely with his right hand, though insensible of prurition, various points and surfaces of his partly exposed, wholly abluted skin. He inserted his left hand into the left lower pocket of his waistcoat and extracted and replaced a silver coin, 1 shilling, placed there, presumably, on the occasion, 17 October 1903, of the interment of Mrs. Emily Sinico, Sydney Parade. Compile the budget for the 16th of June, 1904. Debit. 1 pork kidney, 3p. 1 copy Freeman's Journal, 1p. 1 bath and gratification, 1 shilling and 6p. Tram fare, 1p. In memoriam Patrick Dignam, 5 shillings. 2 Banbury cakes, 1p. 1 lunch, 7p. 1 renewal fee for book, 1 shilling. 1 packet notepaper and envelopes, 2p. 1 dinner and gratification, 2 shillings. 1 postal order and stamp, 2 shillings and 8p. Tram fare, 1p. 1 pig's foot, 4p. 1 sheep's trotter, 3p. 1 cake fries plain chocolate, 1p. 1 square soda bread, 4p. 1 coffee and bun, 4p. Loan, Stephen Dedalus, refunded. £1.7. Balance, 17 shillings and 5p. £2.19 and 3p. Credit. Cash in hand, 4 shillings and 9p. Commission received, Freeman's Journal, £1.7 and 6p. Loan, Stephen Dedalus, £1.7. £2.19 and 3p. Did the process of divestiture continue? Sensible of a benignant, persistent ache in his foot soles, he extended his foot to one side and observed the creases, protuberances, and salient points caused by foot pressure in the course of walking repeatedly in several different directions. Then, inclined, he disnoded the lace knots, unhooked and loosened the laces, took off each of his 2 boots for the second time, detached the partially moistened right sock, through the forepart of which the nail of his great toe had again effracted, raised his right foot, and, having unhooked a purple elastic sock suspender, took off his right sock, placed his unclothed right foot on the margin of the seat of his chair, picked at and gently lacerated the protruding part of the great toenail, raised the part lacerated to his nostrils, and inhaled the odour of the quick, then, with satisfaction, threw away the lacerated unguical fragment. Why with satisfaction? Because the odour inhaled corresponded to other odours inhaled of other unguical fragments, picked and lacerated by Master Bloom, pupil of Mrs. Ellis's juvenile school, patiently each night in the act of brief genuflection and nocturnal prayer and ambitious meditation. In what ultimate ambition had all concurrent and consecutive ambitions now coalesced? Not to inherit by right of primogeniture Gravelkind or Borough English, or possess in perpetuity an extensive domain of a sufficient number of acres, roods and perches, statute land measures, valuation £42, of grazing turbary surrounding a baronial hall, with gate lodge and carriage drive, nor, on the other hand, a terrace house or semi-detached villa, described as Rus in Urbe or Quisi Sana, but to purchase by private treaty in fee simple a thatched bungalow-shaped two-storey dwelling-house of southerly aspect, surmounted by vane and lightning conductor connected with the earth, with porch covered by parasitic plants, ivy or Virginia creeper, hall door, olive green, with smart carriage finish and neat door brasses, stucco front with gilt tracery at eaves and gables, rising, if possible, upon a gentle eminence with agreeable prospect from balcony, with stone pillar parapet over unoccupied and unoccupiable interjacent pastures, and standing in 5 or 6 acres of its own ground, at such a distance from the nearest public thoroughfare as to render its house-lights visible at night above and through a quickset hornbeam hedge of topiary cutting, situate at a given point not less than 1 statute mile from the periphery of the metropolis, within a time limit of not more than 15 minutes from tram or train line, e.g. Dundrum, south, or Sutton, north, both localities equally reported by trial to resemble the terrestrial poles in being favourable climates for physical subjects, the premises to be held under free farm grant, lease 999 years, the messuage to consist of 1 drawing room with bay window, 2 lancets, thermometer affixed, 1 sitting room, 4 bedrooms, 2 servant rooms, tiled kitchen with clothes range and scullery, lounge hall fitted with linen wall presses, fumed oak sectional bookcase containing the Encyclopaedia Britannica and New Century Dictionary, transverse obsolete medieval and oriental weapons, dinner gong, alabaster lamp, bowl pendant, vulcanite automatic telephone receiver with adjacent directory, hand-tufted Axminster carpet with cream ground and trellis border, loo table with pillar and claw legs, hearth with massive fire brasses and ormolu mantel chronometer clock, guaranteed timekeeper with cathedral time, barometer with hydrographic chart, comfortable lounge settees and corner fitments, upholstered in ruby plush with good springing and sunk centre, 3-banner Japanese screen and cuspidors, club style, rich wine-coloured leather, gloss renewable with a minimum of labour by use of linseed oil and vinegar, a pyramidically prismatic centre chandelier lustre, Brentwood perch with finger-tame parrot, expurgated language, embossed mural paper at 10 shillings per dozen, with transverse swags of carmine floral design and top crown frieze, staircase, 3 continuous flights at successive right angles, of varnished clear-grained oak, treads and risers, newel, balusters and handrail, with stepped-up panel dado, dressed with camphorated wax. Bathroom, hot and cold supply, reclining and shower, water closet on mezzanine provided with opaque single-pane oblong window, tip-up seat, bracket lamp, brass tie rod and brace, armrests, footstool, and artistic oleograph on inner face of door. Ditto, plain. Servants' apartments with separate sanitary and hygienic necessaries for cook, general and between maid, salary rising by biennial unearned increments of £2, with comprehensive fidelity insurance, annual bonus £1, and retiring allowance, based on the 65 system, after 30 years' service. Pantry, buttery, larder, refrigerator, out-offices, coal and wood cellarage with wine bin, still and sparkling vintages, for distinguished guests, if entertained to dinner, evening dress, carbon monoxide gas supply throughout. What additional attractions might the grounds contain? As addenda, a tennis and fives court, a shrubbery, a glass summer house with tropical palms, equipped in the best botanical manner, a rockery with water spray, a beehive arranged on humane principles, oval flower beds in rectangular grass plots set with eccentric ellipses of scarlet and chrome tulips, blue scillas, crocuses, polyanthus, sweet william, sweet pea, lily of the valley, bulbs obtainable from Sir James W. Mackey Limited, wholesale and retail seed and bulb merchants and nurserymen, agents for chemical manures, 23 Sackville Street Upper, an orchard, kitchen garden and vinery, protected against illegal trespassers by glass-topped mural enclosures, a lumber shed with padlock for various inventoried implements. As eel traps, lobster pots, fishing rods, hatchet, steelyard, grindstone, clod crusher, swathe turner, carriage sack, telescope ladder, 10-tooth rake, washing clogs, hay tedder, tumbling rake, billhook, paint pot, brush, hoe, and so on. What improvements might be subsequently introduced? A rabbitry and fowl run, a dovecot, a botanical conservatory, two hammocks, ladies and gentlemen's, a sundial shaded and sheltered by laburnum or lilac trees, an exotically harmonically accorded Japanese tinkle gate bell, affixed to left lateral gatepost, a capacious water butt, a lawnmower with side delivery and grass box, a lawn sprinkler with hydraulic hose. What facilities of transit were desirable? When city-bound, frequent connection by train or tram from their respective intermediate station or terminal. When country-bound, velocipedes, a chainless freewheel roadster cycle with side basket car attached, or draft conveyance, a donkey with wicker trap, or smart phaeton with good working solid ungular cob, roan, gelding, 14 hands. What might be the name of this irrigible or erected residence? Bloom Cottage, St. Leopold's, Flowerville. Could Bloom of 7 Eccles Street foresee Bloom of Flowerville? In loose all-wool garments with Harris tweed cap, price 8 and 6, and useful garden boots with elastic gussets and watering can, planting aligned young fir trees, syringing, pruning, staking, sowing hayseed, trundling a weed-laden wheelbarrow without excessive fatigue at sunset, amid the scent of new-mown hay, ameliorating the soil, multiplying wisdom, achieving longevity. What syllabus of intellectual pursuits was simultaneously possible? Snapshot photography, comparative study of religions, folklore, relative to various amatory and superstitious practices, contemplation of the celestial constellations. What lighter recreations? Outdoor, garden and field work, cycling on level macadamized causeways, ascents of moderately high hills, natation in secluded fresh water, and unmolested river boating in secure wherry or light curricle, with kedge anchor on reaches free from weirs and rapids, period of estivation, vespertinal perambulation or equestrian circumprocession, with inspection of sterile landscape and contrastingly agreeable cottagers' fires of smoking peat turves, period of hibernation, indoor, discussion in tepid security of unsolved historical and criminal problems, lecture of expurgated exotic erotic masterpieces, house carpentry, with toolbox containing hammer, awl, nails, screws, tin tacks, gimlet, tweezers, bullnose plane and turn screw. Might he become a gentleman farmer of field produce and livestock? Not impossibly, with one or two stripper cows, one pike of upland hay, and requisite farming implements, e.g. an end-to-end churn, a turnip pulper, etc. What would be his civic functions and social status among the country families and landed gentry? Arranged successively in ascending powers of hierarchical order, that of gardener, groundsman, cultivator, breeder, and, at the zenith of his career, resident magistrate or justice of the peace, with a family crest and coat of arms and appropriate classical motto, Semper Paratus, duly recorded in the court directory, Bloom, Leopold, P., M.P., P.C., K.P., L.L.D., Honoris Causa, Bloomville, Dundrum, and mentioned in court and fashionable intelligence, Mr. and Mrs. Leopold Bloom have left Kingstown for England. What course of action did he outline for himself in such capacity? A course that lay between undue clemency and excessive rigour. The dispensation in a heterogeneous society of arbitrary classes, incessantly rearranged in terms of greater and lesser social inequality, of unbiased, homogeneous, indisputable justice, tempered with mitigants of the widest possible latitude, but exactable to the utmost farthing with confiscation of estate, real and personal, to the Crown. Loyal to the highest constituted power of the land, actuated by an innate love of rectitude, his aims would be the strict maintenance of public order, the repression of many abuses, though not of all simultaneously, every measure of reform or retrenchment being a preliminary solution to be contained by fluxion in the final solution. The upholding of the letter of the law, common statute and law merchant, against all traversers in coven and trespassers acting in contravention of bylaws and regulations. All resuscitators, by trespass and petty larceny of kindlings, of vendel rites, obsolete by desuetude, all orotund instigators of international persecution, all perpetuators of international animosities, all menial molesters of domestic conviviality, all recalcitrant violators of domestic connubiality. Prove that he had loved rectitude from his earliest youth. To Master Percy Apjohn at high school in 1880, he had divulged his disbelief in the tenets of the Irish Protestant Church, to which his father Rudolf Virag, later Rudolf Bloom, had been converted from the Israelitic Faith and Communion in 1865 by the Society for Promoting Christianity Among Jews, subsequently abjured by him in favour of Roman Catholicism, at the epoch of and with a view to his matrimony in 1888, to Daniel McGrain and Francis Wade in 1882, during a juvenile friendship, terminated by the premature emigration of the former. He had advocated, during nocturnal perambulations, the political theory of colonial, e.g. Canadian, expansion, and the evolutionary theories of Charles Darwin, expounded in The Descent of Man and The Origin of the Species. In 1885, he had publicly expressed his adherence to the collective and national economic programme advocated by James Fintan Lawler, John Fisher Murray, John Mitchell, James Francis Xavier O'Brien, and others, the agrarian policy of Michael Davitt, the constitutional agitation of Charles Stewart Parnell, MP for Cork City, the programmes of peace, retrenchment and reform of William Ewart Gladstone, MP for Midlothian, NB, and, in support of his political convictions, had climbed up into a secure position amid the ramifications of a tree on Northumberland Road to see the entrance, 2nd February 1888, into the capital of a demonstrative torchlight procession of 20,000 torchbearers, divided into 120 trade corporations, bearing 2,000 torches in escort of the Marquis of Ripon and Honest John Morley. How much and how did he propose to pay for his country residence? As per prospectus of the Industrious Foreign Acclimatised Nationalised Friendly State-Aided Building Society, incorporated 1874, a maximum of £60 per annum, being one-sixth of an assured income, derived from gilt-edged securities, representing at 5% simple interest on capital of £1,200, estimate of price at 20 years' purchase, of which to be paid on acquisition, and the balance in the form of annual rent, viz. £800 plus 2.5% interest on the same, repayable quarterly in equal annual instalments, until extinction by amortization of loan advanced for purchase within a period of 20 years, amounting to an annual rental of £64, head rent included, the title deeds to remain in possession of the lender or lenders, with a saving clause envisaging forced sale, foreclosure, and mutual compensation in the event of protracted failure to pay the terms assigned. Otherwise, the messuage to become the absolute property of the tenant-occupier upon expiry of the period of years stipulated. What rapid but insecure means to opulence might facilitate immediate purchase? A private wireless telegraph, which would transmit by dot and dash system the result of a national equine handicap, flat or steeplechase, of one or more miles and furlongs, won by an outsider at odds of 50-1, at 3:08 p.m. at Ascot, Greenwich time, the message being received and available for betting purposes in Dublin at 2:59 p.m. Dunsink time. The unexpected discovery of an object of great monetary value, precious stone, valuable adhesive, or impressed postage stamp, 7 shilling mauve, imperforate, Hamburg, 1866, 4 pence, rose, blue paper, perforate, Great Britain, 1855, 1 franc stone, official, rouletted, diagonal surcharge, Luxembourg, 1878. Antique dynastical ring, unique relic. In unusual repositories or by unusual means. From the air, dropped by an eagle in flight. By fire, amid the carbonized remains of an incendiated edifice. In the sea, amid flotsam, jetsam, laggan and derelict. On earth, in the gizzard of a comestible fowl. A Spanish prisoner's donation of a distant treasure of valuables or specie or bullion, lodged with a solvent banking corporation 100 years previously, at 5% compound interest of the collective worth of £5 million sterling. A contract with an inconsiderate contractee for the delivery of 32 consignments of some given commodity, in consideration of cash payment on delivery, per delivery, at the initial rate of 1 farthing, to be increased constantly in the geometrical progression of 2. A farthing, a halfpenny, 1 penny, 2 pence, 4 pence, 8 pence, 1 shilling 4 pence, 2 shilling 8 pence, to 32 terms. A prepared scheme based on a study of the laws of probability to break the bank at Monte Carlo. A solution of the secular problem of the quadrature of the circle. Government premium, £1 million sterling. Was vast wealth acquirable through industrial channels? The reclamation of dunams of waste arenary soil, proposed in the prospectus of Agendathna Time, Bleibhausstrasse, Berlin, W15, by the cultivation of orange plantations and melon fields and reforestation. The utilisation of waste paper, fells of sewer rodents, human excrement, possessing chemical properties, in view of the vast production of the first, vast number of the second, and immense quantity of the third, every normal human being of average vitality and appetite, producing annually, cancelling by-products of water, a sum total of £80, mixed animal and vegetable diet, to be multiplied by 4,386,035, the total population of Ireland according to census returns of 1901. Were there schemes of wider scope? A scheme to be formulated and submitted for approval to the harbour commissioners for the exploitation of white coal, hydraulic power, obtained by hydroelectric plant at peak of tide at Dublin Bar, or at head of water at Paula Fuca or Powers Court, or catchment basins of main streams for the economic production of 500,000 WHP of electricity. A scheme to enclose the peninsular delta of the North Bull at Dollymount and erect on the space of the foreland, used for golf links and rifle ranges, an asphalted esplanade with casinos, booths, shooting galleries, hotels, boarding houses, reading rooms, establishments for mixed bathing. A scheme for the use of dog vans and goat vans for the delivery of early morning milk. A scheme for the development of Irish tourist traffic in and around Dublin by means of petrol-propelled riverboats, plying in the fluvial fairway between Island Bridge and Ringsend, charabancs, narrow-gauge local railways, and pleasure steamers for coastwise navigation. 10 shillings per person per day. Guide, trilingual included. A scheme for the repristination of passenger and goods traffic over Irish waterways when free from weed beds. A scheme to connect by tramline the cattle market, North Circular Road and Prussia Street, with the quays, Sheriff Street Lower and East Wall, parallel with the Link Line Railway laid in conjunction with the Great Southern and Western Railway Line between the Cattle Park, Liffey Junction and terminus of Midland Great Western Railway, 43 to 45 North Wall, in proximity to the terminal stations or Dublin branches of Great Central Railway, Midland Railway of England, City of Dublin Steam Packet Company, Lancashire and Yorkshire Railway Company, Dublin and Glasgow Steam Packet Company, Glasgow, Dublin and Londonderry Steam Packet Company, Laird Line, British and Irish Steam Packet Company, Dublin and Morecambe Steamers, London and North Western Railway Company, Dublin Port and Docks Board Landing Sheds and Transit Sheds of Palgrave, Murphy and Company, Steamship Owners, Agents for Steamers in Mediterranean, Spain, Portugal, France, Belgium and Holland, and for Liverpool Underwriters Association, The cost of acquired rolling stock for animal transport and of additional mileage operated by the Dublin United Tramways Company Limited to be covered by graziers' fees. Positing what protesis, would a contraction for such several schemes become a natural and necessary apodosis? Given a guarantee equal to the sum sought, the support by deed of gift and transfer vouchers during donor's lifetime, or by bequest after donor's painless extinction, of eminent financiers Blumfascia, Rothschild Guggenheim, Hirsch, Montefiore, Morgan, Rockefeller, possessing fortunes in six figures amassed during a successful lifetime, and joining capital with opportunity, the thing required was done. What eventuality would render him independent of such wealth? The independent discovery of a gold seam of inexhaustible ore. For what reason did he meditate on schemes so difficult of realization? It was one of his axioms that similar meditations, or the automatic relation to himself of a narrative concerning himself, or tranquil recollection of the past when practiced habitually before retiring for the night, alleviated fatigue and produced, as a result, sound repose and renovated vitality. His justifications? As a physicist, he had learned that of the 70 years of complete human life, at least 2/7, viz. 20 years, were passed in sleep. As a philosopher, he knew that at the termination of any allotted life, only an infinitesimal part of any person's desires had been realized. As a physiologist, he believed in the artificial placation of malignant agencies, chiefly operative during somnolence. What did he fear? The committal of homicide or suicide during sleep by an aberration of the light of reason, the incommensurable categorical intelligence situated in the cerebral convolutions. What were habitually his final meditations? Of some one sole unique advertisement to cause passers to stop and wonder, a poster novelty, with all extraneous accretions excluded, reduced to its simplest and most efficient terms, not exceeding the span of casual vision and congruous with the velocity of modern life. What did the first drawer unlocked contain? A Vere Foster's handwriting copybook, property of Millie, Millicent, Bloom, certain pages of which bore diagram drawings marked Papley, which showed a large globular head with five hairs erect, two eyes in profile, the trunk full front with three large buttons, one triangular foot. Two fading photographs of Queen Alexandra of England and of Maud Branscombe, actress and professional beauty. A Yuletide card, bearing on it a pictorial representation of a parasitic plant. The legend Mizpah, the date Xmas, 1892. The name of the senders, from Mr. and Mrs. M. Comerford. The versicle, May this Yuletide bring to thee joy and peace and welcome glee. A butt of red partly liquefied sealing wax, obtained from the stores department of Messrs. Healy's Limited, 89, 90 and 91 Dame Street. A box containing the remainder of a gross of gilt J. pen nibs, obtained from same department of same firm. An old sand glass which rolled, containing sand which rolled. A sealed prophecy, never unsealed, written by Leopold Bloom in 1886, concerning the consequences of the passing into law of William Ewart Gladstone's Home Rule Bill of 1886, never passed into law. A bazaar ticket, number 2004, of St. Kevin's Charity Fair, price 6 pence, 100 prizes. An infantile epistle, dated Small M, Monday, reading Capital P, Papley, comma, Capital H, How are you? Note of interrogation, Capital I am very well, full stop, new paragraph, signature with flourishes, Capital M, Millie, no stop. A cameo brooch, property of Ellen Bloom, born Higgins, deceased. A cameo scarf pin, property of Rudolph Bloom, born Virag, deceased. 3 typewritten letters. Addressee, Henry Flower, care of Post Office, Westland Row. Addresser, Martha Clifford, care of Post Office, Dolphin's Barn. The transliterated name and address of the addresser of the 3 letters in reversed alphabetic boustropedonic punctuated quadrilinear cryptogram, vowels suppressed, n.igs.forward/wi.uu.ox/w.oks/mh/y.im. A press cutting from an English weekly periodical, Modern Society. Subject, Corporal Chastisement in Girls' Schools. A pink ribbon which had festooned an Easter egg in the year 1899. 2 partly uncoiled rubber preservatives with reserve pockets, purchased by post from Box 32, Post Office, Charing Cross, London, WC. 1 pack of 1 dozen cream-laid envelopes and faint-ruled notepaper, watermarked, now reduced by 3. Some assorted Austrian-Hungarian coins. 2 coupons of the Royal and Privileged Hungarian Lottery. A low-power magnifying glass. 2 erotic photographs showing A. Buccal coition between nude senorita, rear presentation, superior position, and nude torero, fore presentation, inferior position. B. Anal violation by male religious, fully clothed, eyes abject, of female religious, partly clothed, eyes direct, purchased by post from Box 32, Post Office, Charing Cross, London, WC. A press cutting of recipe for renovation of old tan boots. A 1 penny adhesive stamp, lavender, of the reign of Queen Victoria. A chart of the measurements of Leopold Bloom compiled before, during and after 2 months' consecutive use of Sandow Whitley's pulley exerciser. Men's 15 shillings, athletes 20 shillings, viz. Chest 28 inches and 29.5 inches, biceps 9 inches and 10 inches, forearm 8.5 inches and 9 inches, thigh 10 inches and 12 inches, calf 11 inches and 12 inches. 1 prospectus of the Wonder Worker, the world's greatest remedy for rectal complaints, direct from Wonder Worker, Coventry House, South Place, London, EC, addressed, erroneously, to Mrs. L. Bloom, with brief accompanying note commencing, erroneously, Dear Madam. Quote the textual terms in which the prospectus claimed advantages for this thaumaturgic remedy. It heals and soothes while you sleep in case of trouble and breaking wind. Assists nature in the most formidable way, ensuring instant relief in discharge of gases, keeping parts clean and free. Natural action, an initial outlay of 7 and 6, making a new man of you and life worth living. Ladies find Wonder Worker especially useful. A pleasant surprise when they note delightful result, like a cool drink of fresh spring water on a sultry summer's day. Recommend it to your lady and gentleman friends. Lasts a lifetime. Insert long round end. Wonder Worker. Were there testimonials? Numerous. From clergyman, British naval officer, well-known author, city man, hospital nurse, lady, mother of 5, absent-minded beggar. How did absent-minded beggar's concluding testimonial conclude? What a pity the government did not supply our men with Wonder Workers during the South African campaign. What a relief it would have been. What object did Bloom add to this collection of objects? A 4th typewritten letter received by Henry Flower, let HFBLB, from Martha Clifford, find MC. What pleasant reflection accompanied this action? The reflection that, apart from the letter in question, his magnetic face, form and address had been favourably received during the course of the preceding day by a wife, Mrs. Josephine Breen, born Josie Powell, a nurse, Miss Callan, Christian name unknown, a maid, Gertrude, Gertie, family name unknown. What possibility suggested itself? The possibility of exercising virile power of fascination in the not immediate future, after an expensive repast in a private apartment in the company of an elegant courtesan, of corporal beauty, moderately mercenary, variously instructed, a lady by origin. What did the second drawer contain? Documents. The birth certificate of Leopold Paula Bloom, an endowment assurance policy of £500 in the Scottish Widows Assurance Society, intestated Millicent Millie Bloom, coming into force at 25 years, as with profit policy of £430, £462.10, and £500 at 60 years or death, 65 years or death, and death respectively, or with profit policy paid up of £299.10, together with cash payment of £133.10 at option. A bank passbook issued by the Ulster Bank, College Green Branch, showing statement of account for half year ending 31st December 1903, balance in depositor's favour, £18.14.6 sterling, net personalty. Certificate of possession of £900, Canadian 4% inscribed government stock, free of stamp duty. Dockets of the Catholic Cemetery's Glass Nevin Committee, relative to a grave plot purchased. A local press cutting concerning change of name by deed poll. Quote the textual terms of this notice. I, Rudolf Virag, now resident at No. 52 Clanbrassil Street, Dublin, formerly of Zombathley in the Kingdom of Hungary, hereby give notice that I have assumed and intend henceforth upon all occasions and at all times to be known by the name of Rudolf Bloom. What other objects relative to Rudolf Bloom, born Virag, were in the second drawer? An indistinct daguerreotype of Rudolf Virag and his father Leopold Virag, executed in the year 1852, in the portrait atelier of their, respectively, first and second cousin, Stefan Virag, of Szeszfervár, Hungary. An ancient Haggadah book, in which a pair of horn-rimmed convex spectacles inserted, marked the passage of thanksgiving in the ritual prayers for Pesach, Passover. A photocard of the Queen's Hotel, Ennis, proprietor, Rudolf Bloom. An envelope addressed, To My Dear Son, Leopold. What fractions of phrases did the lecture of those five whole words evoke? Tomorrow will be a week that I received. It is no use, Leopold, to be. With your dear mother, that is not more to stand. To her, all for me is out. Be kind to Athos, Leopold. My dear son, always, of me, das Herz, Gott dein. What reminiscences of a human subject suffering from progressive melancholia did these objects evoke in Bloom? An old man, widower, unkempt of hair, in bed with head covered, sighing. An infirm dog, Athos, aconite, resorted to by increasing doses of grains and scruples as a palliative of recrudescent neuralgia. The face in death of a septuagenarian, suicide by poison. Why did Bloom experience a sentiment of remorse? Because in immature impatience he had treated with disrespect certain beliefs and practices. As the prohibition of the use of flesh meat and milk at one meal. The hebdomadary symposium of co-inordinately abstract, perfervidly concrete mercantile, co-ex-religionist ex-compatriots. The circumcision of male infants, the supernatural character of Judaic scripture, the ineffability of the tetragrammaton, the sanctity of the Sabbath. How did these beliefs and practices now appear to him? Not more rational than they had appeared, not less rational than other beliefs and practices now appeared. What first reminiscences had he of Rudolf Bloom, deceased,